Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to our first annual Enduring Spirit Awards. My name is Robert Green, the incoming Vice President for the Friends of African American Art and Culture, and welcome. I am here this evening to introduce to you the Interim Director of the Columbia Museum of Art, Ms. Lynn Robertson, so please come up, please.
Well, my job tonight is to welcome all of you to this important and exciting occasion. The Friends of African American Art and Culture have been exactly that, wonderful friends to the Columbia Museum of Art. They have sponsored exhibitions, they've organized programs, but most importantly, they've encouraged us and spurred us on to have conversations about culture, about art, and about what really matters in our community. Yesterday, when I was driving to work, I was listening to an interview by the producer of the new Wonder Woman movie, which everyone is talking about. And she was talking about a conversation she had with a little girl who had picked out a number of Wonder Woman comics. And she said, well, why did you pick out these? There are lots of superhero comics. And she said, because Wonder Woman is a strong woman who saves people. And I was thinking driving in here tonight that we're here to celebrate strong women in our own community who save people, but most of all save institutions, who make our community better and stronger and more vibrant and happier. So it's going to be a wonderful evening. And again, I welcome all of you into the Columbia Museum of Art. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Lynn. Good evening. I'm Beryl Dakers, and as a member of the Friends of African American Art and Culture's board, I am delighted to serve as your host for this wonderful event. We are thrilled to sponsor the event, which highlights the nexus between community and the arts and celebrates the best of both. And we are most grateful to have you share this experience with us and our most deserving honorees. And now for your official welcome and introductions, please welcome to the microphone the dynamic duo of our very, very immediate past president, as of just a few minutes ago, Mr. Darian McLeod, and our equally newly elected incoming president, Ms. Michelle Dugar.
Thank you. Darian could not join us this evening, but I bring greetings on behalf of us both and FAAAC. And for those of you who may not be familiar with FAAAC, the name says so much, Friends of African American Arts and Culture. And back in the day when I was in undergrad, there was a t-shirt that said, it's a black thing, you wouldn't understand. I don't know if anyone remembers that, but you do? But what we're seeking is understanding of the African American culture and to celebrate the vibrancy of that. And it goes beyond art on walls to include culture. And tonight is such an opportunity to do just that, to reflect and celebrate African American culture, in particular women within our community. And this evening we had an opportunity to celebrate those that really reflect the best of us, our sass, our style, our sacrifice, and our spirit, the enduring spirit. So I say thank you for joining us. Thank you to our honorees for being who they are, and enjoy your evening.
I want to take just a moment to acknowledge someone who has been very, very essential and indispensable to this effort. Jerry Delgemarck has been a remarkable board member and supporter of FAAAC since its inception, and she has done so unselfishly, giving of her time, her service, and her financial support. One of her most impactful acts was to purchase Tyrone Jeter's work, I Done Old and I Done Tired, as a gift for the Columbia Museum of Art. A second notable act was originating the idea behind this awards program. Please join me in thanking Jerry Dell, who's going to protest, but I am going to ask her to come up for just a moment.
You know, it's just such a pleasure and excitement to be here tonight and to celebrate the contributions of African-American women to this community, and to see that as it's reflected with the art that Tyrone Jeter has produced that's in the show now. It's a great gift to us all to have these women who are friends of ours to make a difference in our community.
Thank you very much, Jerry Dell. Now, we would not be here were it not for the works of our artist of the hour. So a special word of thanks goes to the artist, Tyrone Jeter, for without his amazing talent, the creation of this wonderful exhibition, and the sharing of his exemplary philosophies about life, love, enduring spirit, his love and honor for the women in his life, and the need to communicate through his work, we would not be here today. Now, I'm not going to give you Tyrone's biography. You may read about him and the award in your program, but I am going to give you the opportunity to at least get a close gander at him. Come on, Tyrone. Those of you who know him well know that he is a stubborn cuss, but I think he'll come on up.
I have no idea what to say to you. I can tell you this, that I've been here 18 years now, and this is possibly the most exciting thing that's happened to me in those 18 years. And it's not, I mean, the show itself was important, and the fact that I got so much support from this museum, it's been incredible. And you know who I really love out there, right? Jerry Dell. So, and I appreciate every second of that. But the thing that really, really touches me the most is that you guys looked through the work and saw the essence of it. And the essence is just like you said, it was about my mother and the women in my life who has kept me straight my entire life. And this is just a topping on everything. It makes everything worth wow, and I really appreciate you, and I'm never going to forget you for this. I can promise you that. And my sister said thank you also.
Thank you, Tyrone. And he did it without too much argument. That's amazing. This exhibit has really mellowed this man, I want you to know. If you were not here at the Columbia Museum on May 12th for the amazing father-daughter museum talk experience by Tyrone and his daughter, the burgeoning poet Hafeeza Jeter, then you really missed a treat. I think it's on the museum's website, maybe. And so if you were not here, I certainly would encourage you to take a gander at it as soon as possible. If you were here, you may want to just revisit it for the inspirational messages that you will receive. What better person, however, to bring greetings and congratulations at this event than Ms. Hafeeza Jeter. Please direct your attention to the screen.
When I think of an enduring spirit, I think that I think of someone who, in spite of the trials and tribulations that life throws at us, is able to find joy. Because we all live lives that have challenges, but I think the act of joy is a radical act, and be able to find joy in really difficult times, I think that is the endurance of the spirit, that perseverance, doing whatever it takes at whatever cost, and also just like the courage to follow your own dream, and having enough courage that other people's dreams don't threaten yours. I think that to have an enduring spirit requires curiosity. I think if you're curious, you are learning, and you're not relying necessarily on your teachers or your educational system to teach you, but you have a curiosity not just about, you know, facts of the world, but the culture of the world, the other people's experiences. And so if you have that curiosity, you're open to it. And once you open yourself up to those possibilities, you see what is possible for yourself. And so when you see the possibility that you can achieve, you're willing to work hard because you know what's on the other side of that. Congratulations on winning the Enduring Spirit Award. But more than congratulations, thank you. An enduring spirit is something that everyone in a community benefits from. It's an example set to young girls and also to other fellow women. Because as we all know, the world is in great need of enduring spirits, especially women who are the backbone of our society. So congratulations again, and thank you again.
And thank you, Hafisa. Now, we were ecstatic to have the community embrace the concept of the Enduring Spirit Awards. And I'd like to tell you folks, there were some really superb nominations, about 19 or 20 in all. And at this point, if they're here, I would like to have the other nominees please stand and be recognized. They are Lydia Bailey Paget, psychologist, counselor, mental health advocate, Jennifer Shireen Bartel, a teacher, writer, poet, and spoken word performer, Corey Mosby Boyce, music educator and choral director, the Reverend Rosalind Grant Coleman, chaplain, presiding AME elder, pastor, and teacher, award-winning author, writer, blogger, Cynthia Leggett Davis, don't be shy, National Book Award winner, poet and professor, Nikki Finney, filmmaker, educator, photographer, and fine artist, Ronnie Nicole Henderson, Manifa Lemons, spoken word artist, creative consultant, and also known as Sila the Poet, Rosina Reese Lucas, longtime educator, social worker, thank you, Miss Lucas, community volunteer, and a fixture from my childhood, so glad to have you here, Vinnie Dees Moore, author, photographer, community activist, and volunteer. Is Vinny not here? My goodness. Burton Pack principal, education specialist, and achievement gap closer, Sarah G. Smith. She's here in the audience with us. Thank you. And Tracy Anderson Swilly, visionary education specialist and principal at Fairfield Central High School. Ladies and gentlemen, this was a very tough competition. And each of these ladies is a powerhouse spirit who deserves our recognition, our thanks, and our applause for all their service. Thank you. And now, as a prelude to the awards presentation, we would like to welcome a wonderful vocalist, Mrs. Christine McClellan, a soprano who is an alumna of the Benedict College Concert Choir. She has chosen a most deserving and fitting selection, Still I Rise, as rendered by Yolanda Adams. Christine. Shaken,
But here I stand, weary, still I press on. Long are the nights, the tears I cried. Dark are the days, no sun in the sky. Against all odds, yet still I rise high above the clouds. At times I feel low, yet still troubled, but not in despair. Struggling, I make my way through. Trials, they come to make me strong. I must endure. Against all odds, yet still I rise high above the clouds. At times I feel low, yet still I rise above all my problems. Above all my eyes can see, knowing God is able to strengthen me, to strengthen me, yet still I rise, never to give up. Against all odds, yet still I rise high above the clouds. At times I feel low, yet still
Thank you so much, Christine. And thank you, Dr. Linda Kershaw, for bringing us Benedict's tribute for today. We appreciate that so much. And we'll hear from Christine again in just a moment. Right now, however, we are going to move into the awards presentation, and we're thrilled that members of the Friends of African American Art and Culture's Board of Directors will be presenting the awards in the individual categories. There were four categories, and the solicitations were made to the community, and you responded. At this point, I'd like to ask Michaela Pilar. Are you here? She is here. If Michaela Pilar Brown will come and present our first award.
Good evening. Good evening. Kadenya Williams-Javis is a woman on a mission, determined to assist her community move the needle forward on financial literacy, empowering young and old with the tools needed to advance their standing in the American dream. Proprietor and Chief Financial Officer of Javis Financial Services, Mrs. Williams-Javis is dedicated to providing assistance to individuals and businesses with their tax concerns and questions. With more than 15 years as a banking and finance professional, she established Javis Financial Services in 2010, working with individuals from all walks of life and differing stages of financial independence and understanding. She furthered her commitment to these efforts with the establishment of the nonprofit Future Business Leaders of America Scholarship Foundation in 2014. Through the FBLA Foundation, she educates on all facets of business and financial literacy, as well as leadership and service. She offers seminars on personal and business finances, transferable skills, career development, ethics, and entrepreneurship. The wife of Christopher L. Javis and mother of Kristen, Caitlin, Morgan, and Megan, Kadenya Williams-Javis is active throughout her community. She volunteers through her memberships with Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority and Word of God Church Ministries. She's a regular speaker on panels and programs advocating for financial literacy. And as proof of her endearing spirit, she has already been recognized by the Greater Irmo Chamber of Commerce and Midlands Women on the Move. It is my great honor to introduce Kadenya Williams-Javis, our Enduring Spirit Award winner in the area of business and finance. We have Ms. Gwen Tidwell accepting on her behalf.
Thank you, ladies. Our next presenter is Ms. Dolores Logan, board member and arts supporter, advocate, board member of the Columbia Museum of FAAC, and person you see at every arts event. Here's Dolores.
Thank you, Beryl. It's my pleasure to laud Harriet Green. Is she still in the room? I'm thrilled to be able to do this presentation of Harriet Green's Enduring Spirit, the Arts Award. For those of you who don't know Harriet Green, she truly is at her very core driven by the arts. And she has been recognized as such for many years. Tonight, we get a chance to brag about Harriet. She'd never do it herself. Her bio is in the program. She's a USC history grad, art history grad, who started her career right here as registrar and then later as assistant curator of the Columbia Museum of Art. So Harriet was one of our hidden figures, a foundation builder. She went on to the South Carolina Arts Commission, where she serves as director of visual arts. Much of the arts activity that we see throughout the state and region are activities that Harriet has had her hands on. I don't know when Harriet developed her life concept, but all of us who know her are aware that she definitely has clearly identified her life concept, and it's all about the arts. Harriet is shoulder to shoulder with the best of the arts world. Ken May, director of the South Carolina Arts Commission, sums up Harriet's work ethic as whatever she does, and I quote, she brings her relentless dedication to the highest standards of quality, otherwise known as doing it to death. Harriet knows only one standard, excellence. She's well known throughout South Carolina, the Southeast region, and she's nationally recognized as an arts administrator. She has partnered with state agencies in South Carolina, North Carolina, Georgia, Tennessee, to name just a few in the region. She's also been selected to the National Register of Peer Professionals, where she's part of a group that establishes nationwide policies and procedures that is involved in critiquing concept designs that are under development and the development of governmental structures, monuments, and in some cases, buildings, I think, that add to the value that contribute to the legacy of public architecture. If you want to envision some of the programs that Harriet may have at some point been involved with, think South Carolina African American Monument. Think Philip Simmons Fence. Think Fallen Firefighter Memorial. North Carolina Freedom Project, Spoleto, the State Arts Collection, the Arts Transit Project, the Columbia Music Festival. These are just a few. Harriet has also designed important arts events like a two-year project, Views from the Edge of the Century, a millennium project that involved 30 museums and art centers throughout South Carolina to celebrate art and artists in our state. Throughout her work, and she is one of the hardest, most effective art professionals ever to grace our state, Harriet is quietly behind the scenes ensuring a top-notch, memorable, honorable, appropriate, gorgeous art event. Harriet, we stand on your broad, extremely competent shoulders. Here at FAAAC, we are particularly indebted to you for your early continuing assistance in our effort to bring the best art made by African American artists and the best arts programming and fun events that we could access to FAAAC and by extension to be shared by all who come to the Columbia Museum of Art. Here we find an ever-increasing, broad, inclusive survey of the objects and ideas that a world-class museum has to offer. And so it is with this woman of South Carolina, this arts professional of the highest order, our unparalleled Harriet Green, who has informed and affected us all, and whom we are proud to recognize as our inaugural Enduring Spirit Arts. Harriet, would you please come up?
Thank you.
I guess I should. She said, thank you. Well, of course, I didn't prepare speech, but I'm always pretty good on my feet. So, as stated, I did start my career at the Columbia Museum of Art.
Let me grab
so it's kind of come full circle. No, that speech starts with me growing up in Holly Hill on a farm. You don't have to grab a chair for this one. But I am truly happy to accept this award, and I do want to thank Jerry Delgamark, who nominated me. And I look around this room, and I see a lot of my supporters. And they are the ones that keep me going. They really are. They are the ones that I draw my energy from. And I'm very thankful to have such good friends. And I mean, there are many of you out here, and I really appreciate you coming out and sharing this special moment with me. And I hope we can continue to all be enduring spirits and support the arts, because we're going to really need a lot of it in the future. Thank you.
I'd be remiss if I did not note that Harriet has brought several of her colleagues with her, and her boss is here. Ken May is looking on to make sure things, yes, indeed. I can attest to the fact, folks, it's 1 a.m. The telephone rings. Oh, God. It's Harriet. We have a luncheon at 11 o'clock tomorrow. Beryl, I don't have the video yet. She is an amazing taskmaster who solicits your help and then makes you sit down because she wants to do it right. Harriet Green, thank you. Our next presenter is Samyette Jones in the area of education. By the way, the lovely bouquets were designed and donated by none other than Tom Chin of Gallery 701. Thank you, Tom. I would say he may have done them in Harriet's honor.
Good evening, everyone. It gives me great pleasure to present the award in the category of education to Marjorie Britton Hammock. She has been a practicing social worker for 57 years. She is a gold card member of the National Association of Social Workers. Ms. Hammock was a member of the NASW National Board and chaired national committees. She is a past president of the South Carolina chapter and is also a retired assistant professor and field coordinator in the social work department at Benedict College. I met this lady many years ago at a cross-cultural conference for mental health and social work professionals. I thought she was the coolest chick I had ever met. She is the phenomenal woman Maya Angelou speaks of. She exudes a confidence, poise, and elegance that is extraordinary, but is so down to earth and approachable, funny, and always willing to share her knowledge and experience because she wants us all to be the best we can be. She has many recognitions, awards, and accolades to her credit. One thing that you may not know that I found out reading her bio is that she provides biopsychosocial assessments as an expert witness for the defense and death penalty cases. Fierce. The reason we honor her tonight is because of her love and passion for the arts. She continues to teach us how to appreciate the inspiring beauty of art in its many forms, and we love and appreciate her for that. Ladies and gentlemen, our Enduring Spirit winner in education, Marjorie Britton Hammock.
Thank you.
unlike Harriet. I don't do well on my feet. So I wrote at least four sentences. First, I am very grateful for this award. It acknowledges what I have loved doing all my life, and that is teaching, helping people, articulating the way in which we really have to address the trials and tribulations that we face. And of course, all my life, all things African-American and African, being an advocate for all and all of those in social justice. I embrace this award, this enduring spirit, and I'm especially proud to be linked with my colleague, my friend, Tyrone Jeter, whose work always inspires me. He gives me hope and also the challenge to continue to be just as mean and forceful and direct as I can be. Thank you.
She is a force to be reckoned with. Activist and advocate and avant-garde spiritualist, Marge Hammock is a mess. And I will have to tell you, she very modestly referenced her relationship with Tyrone Jeter, but she has been right behind him, pushing him every step of the way, as a major, major supporter. And Marge, we thank you for all you've done for our community. Okay. I'm getting happy up here because I know these folks. Okay. Our next awardee will be presented by Ms. Suzanne Thorpe.
It is a privilege and an honor to introduce Judy Mitchell Batiste as the Enduring Spirit Award Community Champion. It's easy enough to begin this introduction, but it's really difficult to end it because of the depth and breadth of her many contributions to our community. Judy was born into a family of educators, and she picked up on that. She has a master's degree in education and also in information and library science. But that family also instilled the value of community service to her. And she has exemplified this value through more than 30 years of service with organizations as varied as the Catani Foundation, the Mansimons Cottage, Riverbank Zoo, Columbia Green, the Nickelodeon, I mean, it goes on and on, and I hope you'll read through the list in the bio in your program. The latest, I guess, are mostly related to her passion for jazz. She initiated the Somersets at the Township Auditorium, and most recently, jazz at 701 Whaley. As if the list isn't long enough, I learned today that Judy has served for 8 years on the selection committee for the Future Leaders Scholarship Program that provides college assistance to students with financial need in the listening area. It is really an impressive list of what she's done for us all. So I felt that one of the best summaries of what Judy was about was written actually by Harriet Green. Oh, God, I hope that's not mine. Thank you. What can I say? So this is what Harriet had to say. Her work with cultural, educational, political, and social causes at the grassroots and advanced levels have been quiet and selfless acts for the greater good of the community. The essence of Judy is not necessarily linked to the fanfare that accompanies great work, but is bound to the lasting impressions that she creates with her overwhelmingly compassionate and steadfast work ethic and zest to make a difference in the lives of the people she touches. I want to conclude with something that Tyrone Jeter wrote. He said, "My work embodies compassion, hope, justice, and perseverance, all qualities that characterize the life and work of Judy Batiste." So, Judy, please come up.
Well, this is going to be an interesting night, Beryl, because Beryl knows that I like to be behind the scenes. I don't like to be out front. Don't talk a lot. Probably most of you have not heard me say more than three or four sentences, but tonight's a different night, and I'm going to tell some stories. Thank you so much for coming out today to support the Columbia Museum of Art, the Friends of African American Art and Culture, and Tyrone Jeter's powerful exhibit, Enduring Spirit. I am immensely honored that FAAAC feels that my work in the community is worthy of the Enduring Spirit Champion of Community Service Award. It is even more gratifying to be associated with an award that was inspired by Tyrone's wife, daughter, and his mother, whose values influenced him greatly. I admire Tyrone as an artist and as a friend, and actually feel a deep connection and kinship. Tyrone and I both were born in Alabama. We both have family members who migrated to the North, and we both were raised by women of enduring strength, spirit, wisdom, who greatly influenced our lives. I was raised in a family where community service was valued and expected. I had role models that demonstrated the whys and hows and importance of service to community throughout my life. I was taught that we had a responsibility to help our family members and our neighbors. I was taught that we should help advance our communities, and because our history in this country, we as a people, out of necessity, have been involved in community service from the day we set foot on this land until today. My great-grandmother, Maggie Drake, was the daughter of Ephraim. He was bought in North Carolina and brought to Alabama to serve as a companion to Dr. John Hodges Drake, the first college doctor at then Alabama Polytechnic Institute, now Auburn University. My great-grandmother cooked at fraternity houses and saved enough money to buy a house where she raised my grandmother, Annie Lee Drake. Grandma Maggie provided a community service by example. I am sure there were those in the community who said, "If Miss Maggie can do that, so can I." My grandmother, Annie Lee Drake Foster, had a fourth grade education, but was one of the smartest people I have known. I loved her dearly and learned so much from her. She raised 10 children, 3 grandchildren, and others in the community who needed a home. She and her husband had a meat market and a restaurant. And later in life, she visited libraries, museums, and schools to share with young people what it was like to be a centenarian. She lived to be 105 years old. My grandmother Foss, as I called her, served her community by reaching out to help others. Each one help one. My aunt Elizabeth Jackson, who's not here tonight, but who is in Columbia with me, migrated to Detroit. She migrated north like Tyrone's mother. She's 99 years old And Aunt Elizabeth started out working as a domestic, cleaning houses for others, of others. Next, she had a job at a meatpacking plant. But her big break came when she got a job at Ford Motor Company, working on the assembly line, putting locks on car doors. She became involved with the union, joined the NAACP, and did pioneering work with the A. Philip Randolph Trade Union Leadership Council. She became involved in politics and was a protege of the late Mayor Coleman Young. My Aunt Elizabeth became a major player in the civic and political life of Detroit. She retired as an international representative of the United Auto Workers. She worked with others inside and outside of organizations to affect change in her community. My parents, Elsie and Daniel Mitchell, were teachers and the first in their families to attend college. They taught at home, at work, at church, and in the community. Teachers and preachers were often at the forefront of movements and issues in the community. My parents helped students and their families by tutoring, helping find jobs, clothes, or food, and by encouraging and assisting students into college. My mother's special area of interest was the elderly. She helped community members who could not read or write, gave assistance with transportation, health care, and more. Today, she probably would have been a geriatric social worker. My father taught advanced math and physics and coached football and basketball at our segregated high school. He encouraged many students to go into the science fields and taught swimming in the summer. Every black child in my hometown of Auburn could swim and understood water safety because of my father. My parents used their talents and interests to help their neighbors and their community. My father's family was from Montgomery. They participated in the bus boycott, and my Uncle Nelson was Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s barber and a photographer. His photographs are included in the Civil Rights Collection at Alabama State University. These observations of my family in action showed me that you do not have to be rich, famous, or formally educated to provide service to your community. You do not have to make a big splash. Little ripples are just as effective. You merely need a desire and willingness to participate in any way you can to help others, advance your community, and make a difference. When I received the email from Brandolin informing me of this award, my initial reaction was, I don't do anything special. I merely do what I should be doing, what I derive joy from. I am an example of an ordinary person who has used my path in life, wherever it has taken me, work, church, social and civic organizations, boards and committees, anywhere, to use my interests and talents to help my fellow man, my community, and hopefully to make the world a better place in some small way. I am fortunate to have a husband who shares my passion for community service. I do not like attention and prefer to work quietly in the background. So this evening is very different for me. I decided that maybe I'm on this stage this evening in part to tell a story, to give a message, as Tyrone does so incredibly through his art. Lest we forget, our ancestors gave a lot in blood, sweat, and tears through community service to get us where we are today. We have a strong legacy in community service that we must find important and continue. I saw a quote, which I have framed large on the wall in my kitchen. And every day I look at it and it reminds me of what I should be doing with my life. It reads, "This is the beginning of a new day. You have been given this day to use as you will. You can waste it or use it for good. What you do today is important because you are exchanging a day of your life for it. When tomorrow comes, this day will be gone forever. In its place is something that you have left behind. Let it be something good." Thank you again for thinking me worthy of this award and believing that I do good in the community. Thank you.
Now that was something. I've got to tell you, I've known Judy Batiste and worked with her on many things for over 40 years. I never heard her talk like that before. I used to think of Judy as quiet thunder. I'm gonna have to find another adjective. Well deserved, and thank you, Judy, for all you do. And now, as we move into our final category, I will welcome to the stage and the mic, I may not get it back, Brandilyn Pinkston, who will present the enduring spirits in the centenarian category. Brandilyn.
Shy.
Gee, I had no idea. I was thinking that Beryl would do it all. That's what we were asking. But tonight has been especially lovely, and you all look lovely, and I'm just so honored to talk about these centenarians. But we have presenters, people that will present them. And you'll see these beautiful ladies as they come to the stage. Our first presenter, We thought that to add to the program, we were talking about enduring spirits, and each of these three ladies is an enduring spirit, not because they're centenarians, but because they have wonderful lives, and they endured, and they are spirited. And I'm not going to take away from their the comments, but Therese, would you please come and make the presentation to our first recipient. Thank
you. Good evening. They say that teachers touch the future, but to paraphrase a quote from Henry Adams, a great teacher affects eternity. She can never tell where her influence stops. Ruby Ella Nixon Shumpert was, and I suspect still is, a great teacher. She is the third of nine children born to Sumter Nixon and Ella Bell Suber Nixon. She received her high school education at Harbison Institute in Irmo. And she wants me to make sure I tell you that she was valedictorian at Harbison Institute, and she was among the first class of girls at the school. So it was a big deal for girls to attend Harbison, and she was among the first. She matriculated at Barbara Scotia and Benedict Colleges and obtained her Master of Education degree from South Carolina State and did further studies at Wake Forest and the University of South Carolina. She began her professional career in Lexington County, where she served as an elementary and high school teacher, head teacher, and elementary principal. Later in her career, she worked at C.A. Johnson High School, where she was guidance counselor, chairman of the math department, and she co-authored a textbook on mathematics. After retiring from District 1, she worked at Benedict College as a professor of mathematics for 10 years. Achieving 50 years as an educator, Mrs. Shumpert realized that education was a key part of her life. She believed in educating the whole child before it became popular to do so. Mrs. Shumpert is a member of St. John Baptist Church, and she has held membership in numerous professional and civic organizations, including Zeta Phi Beta Sorority, Broad River Heights Community Association, the South Carolina Education Association, and Benedict College Alumni Club No. 1. She has been honored as an outstanding educator by the National Association of University Women and named Woman of the Year by the American Business Women. Mrs. Shumpert was married to the late John Barton Shumpert, and from that union came two daughters, Laverne S. Bassard and Lamaris S. Mack. Mrs. Shumpert also has four grandchildren, and two of whom I met tonight, and five great-grandchildren. She turns 100 years old in November. Please join me in recognizing Mrs. Ruby Ella Nixon Shumpert, one of our enduring spirits.
We can wait for you, Ms. Shumpert. Boy, I think back to C.A. Johnson and algebra, Lord.
Would you like to say something? Would you like to say something?
I don't have a speech.
You don't have to have a speech.
I wish to thank this organization for inviting me and naming me to be presented tonight. I would like also to have my descendants, my daughter, my grandchildren, and great-grand to stand and let you know that they are here to stand. Thank you. And all of my friends, students, co-workers, and neighbors, and other friends in the community who came to support me, would you stand? I just want you to know that I have friends, even at my age. Thank you so much. I don't have a speech, and I know you've heard some wonderful messages, so you don't need to hear anymore. Thank you.
Take a picture.
Thank you so much, Mrs. Shumpert. Lamaris, remember those days at Fox School of Dance? My goodness, Laverne. Oh, I tell you, we're about to be enduring spirits up here. Okay. Thank you very much, Mrs. Ruby Ella Nixon Shumpert. And no, you're not seeing double, but we have a twin act coming, so Carla Daniels, Dr. Carla Daniels, will you please come and present our next honoree?
Good evening. It is my pleasure to introduce Mrs. Mabel Nixon Guider, who is 101 years young. She is an amazing woman who has led an exemplary life. Mrs. Guider grew up in the Pine Grove community and graduated from Harbison Institute. She is the widow of Stephen Guider, whom she lovingly cared for during the many years of his illness. Mrs. Guider believes in the African proverb, it takes a village, and has also selflessly cared for her six siblings and many of her neighbors during their illnesses. Mrs. Guider is the mother of one son, Mike, who is married to Kathy. Mrs. Guider has one granddaughter and one grandson. She is also a member of Pine Grove AME Church, where she has been honored for her service. She currently serves as mother of the church. Mrs. Guider has also been a member of many organizations, including Pine Grove Community Club and Booker T. Heights Neighborhood Association and Garden Club. She has won awards for her floral arrangements and quilts. She has been a force for good and a stabilizing influence on those around her. As a child, Mrs. Guider was smaller than her eight siblings and used to tell them, "I'm a little piece of leather that's well put together." And ladies and gentlemen, that she is, a little piece of leather that's well put together and an enduring spirit. When I grow up, I want to be just like her. Please welcome Mrs. Mabel Nixon Guider.
Did you want to say something, Ms. Guider?
Ma'am.
Did you want to say something?
Yes.
Okay. Go right
ahead. That was my sister who was speaking just a few minutes ago. She forgot to tell you, but I got to tell her, because I'm the boss.
That little piece of leather wanted you to know that that was her younger sister who was up here before. They are too much. Gloria, these are the aunts you've been talking about all this time. Good to see. And now for our next presentation, please welcome back to the microphone, the one, the only, Brandilyn Thomas Pinkston.
Thank you. And Gloria, I'd like to thank you too for all that you did in helping with this portion of the program. Thank you. It is indeed my pleasure to introduce the Enduring Spirit Legend Award, because if you are 108 years old, and did you see Ms. Mabel Nixon get up these steps? That's worth a clap. And didn't need Robert to help her up. Came up herself, so that is wonderful.
You know, at the beautiful age of 108, Ms. Donella Brown Wilson is a powerful and enduring inspiration. In the span of her long life, she has witnessed tedious struggle, remarkable change, and extraordinary accomplishments. Blessed with phenomenal recall, Mrs. Wilson paints a vivid picture of the environment where her great-grandparents toiled as enslaved laborers on a Calhoun County plantation known as Lang Syne. And she remembers the poignant Bible lessons and fervent prayers rendered by her grandfather. Her great-grandmother, Annika Spann Bryant, worked as a midwife. Her grandmother, Mary Bryant Weeks, a gardener at Lang Syne, served as the model for the central fictional African-American character in Julia Peterkin's novel, Scarlet Sister Mary. Mrs. Wilson's strong voice reminds listeners of the stony roads generations have trod since the turn of the 20th century. Mrs. Wilson also reminds us of the enduring struggle for freedom and equality among African Americans. Following the federal court ruling of Elmore versus Rice in 1947, African American residents in Columbia prepared to vote in August of 1948. With a white dress and a black umbrella, Mrs. Wilson, at the age of 39, endured the heat as she waited at the front of the line in Columbia's Ward 9 precinct. Since that moving day in 1948, Mrs. Wilson has insisted that voting is a necessary and effective means of speaking truth to power. I believe in that. She has never missed an election. In recent years, elected officials greet her as she arrives to vote at the Prince Hall Masonic Lodge, with vivid memories of segregation and the often brutal steps taken to suppress African American voters. Mrs. Wilson was especially proud to cast her vote for Barack Obama. A champion of civil rights, Mrs. Wilson is a life member of the NAACP, and she has maintained membership in the organization since she paid 25 cents dues when she joined in the eighth grade at Allen University. In the 1950s, when the state of South Carolina forbade public school teachers from being members of the NAACP, Mrs. Wilson refused to drop her membership. She remarked, "Now they can control my job by not giving me a job, but they can't control my mind." Mrs. Wilson continues to impart this enduring lesson. Today, Mrs. Donella Wilson is hailed as the oldest resident of the Waverly community, the oldest active voter in South Carolina, the oldest living graduate of Allen University, the oldest living former student of the legendary Booker T. Washington, the oldest member of Zeta Phi Beta sorority in the country, and the oldest member of the United Tents, Order of Tents in the country, and the oldest member of the United Family Fort Mott reunion. Ladies and gentlemen, she was unable to be with us tonight, but her daughters are here, Minnie and Pat. Would you please join us? Pat Clayton and Minnie Bivens.
Thank you so much.
You.
Hey, girl.
Thank you, Brandy.
Thank you. Well, endure us just a little. Mama couldn't be here tonight because at 108, her body is deteriorating a little faster than her mind. So she gave me some words to tell you tonight, and I will read them for you. She said them, and my sister Patricia is an English major, so she punctuated them. This is a picture of Mama when she was in her 90s, and this is a picture of Mama when she graduated from Allen University. These are her words. Good evening. I am honored and touched by this recognition. Although I am unable to be with you physically for this special evening, please know that I am with you in mind and spirit. I want to express my appreciation to the Friends of African American Art for thinking of me and for honoring my lifetime commitment of living justly, loving, with mercy, and walking humbly with my God. I also want to express my appreciation to Mr. Tyrone Jeter. You were born with a gift, and thank you for allowing your mother's spirit and her lessons to you to move through your heart, your mind, and your hands as you produce such powerful and inspiring artwork. She would be so proud of you, and I am proud of you. I am grateful that the Lord has kept me here for so long, and I'm grateful for all the women who have guided me along the way. I want you to know that the hand that rocks the cradle is the hand that rules the world. We've come a long way from the plantation where I was born 108 years ago in Fort Mott, South Carolina. But look around, read the news, we still have some stony roads ahead of us. As we celebrate tonight, let us never lose sight of our responsibility to teach and guide. We must teach our young people about their foundation. We must teach them about their history and the shoulders upon which they stand. We must teach them to love and respect their elders and their women, as we must teach them about the power and the responsibility of voting. 70 years ago, I stood in long lines in an August heat, waiting for my chance to know my right to vote in the Democratic Party primary. I voted that day, and I've been voting ever since. What about you? I thank God for this amazing journey, and I thank God for each of you. Thank you so much. I also want to say, yes, we grew up with Mrs. Shumpert, her sister, Gloria Burrell. All of us have known each other a long time. But there's one young one lady I wanted to tell you that my mama taught at Roberts High School in Holly Hill, South Carolina. But you were too young. I think she had gone by then. Thank you so much, and we appreciate it.
I gotta tell you folks, this is so exciting to me. Miss Donella Wilson lived in the block below us when I was growing up. Now she was a preacher's wife. Reverend Wilson and my dad were very good friends. But now there was nothing quiet and reserved about Miss Donella. So she made her mark on all of us. And it is a joy to be able to witness this presentation. Please tell her hello for us all. Spirit's getting to me up here. Okay. Christine, would you please favor us with our final song? It's Hero. It's arranged by Mariah Carey. And while she's coming up, I'd like to take this opportunity to tell you all that the gallery is open. This is one of your final opportunities to see Tyrone Jeter's Enduring Spirit exhibition. Please take advantage of it as you fellowship after this gathering. The reception is awaiting your presence. Thank you.
It's truly been an honor to be here tonight and witness these awards being given and to read the stories, the bios, and to hear of your legacies tonight. I want to thank you for allowing me to be here. When I was contacted to do this, my daughters, I have three daughters, and they all got so excited for me because I'm very busy with them all the time. I don't get to sing as often as I'd like, but they're always excited for me, so I'm looking forward to going home and sharing the book with them. I've got two in high school now and one going to fifth grade, and we have to teach our children. We have to every day. I speak Psalm 91 over them, and I pray and cry for them and want them to be successful and to have enduring spirits, whether they're making ripples or waves. So for this final selection, Hero by Mariah Carey, I hope it blesses you tonight.
There's a hero. If you look inside your heart, you don't have to be afraid of what you are. There's an answer. If you reach into your soul, and the sorrow that you know will melt away. And then a hero comes along with the strength to carry on. And you cast your fears aside, and you know you can survive. So when you feel like hope is gone, look inside you and be strong, and you'll finally see the truth that a hero lies in you. It's a long road when you face the world alone. No one reaches out a hand for you to hold. You can find love if you search within yourself, and the emptiness you felt will disappear. And then a hero comes along with the strength to carry on, and you cast your fears aside, and you know you can survive. So when you feel like hope is gone, look inside you and be strong, and you'll finally see the truth that a hero lies in you. But don't let anyone tear them away. Yeah. Hold on. There will be tomorrow. In time, you'll find the way. And then a hero comes along with the strength to carry on, and you cast your fears aside, and you know you can survive. So when you feel like hope is gone, look inside you and be strong, and you'll finally see the truth that a hero lies in you. That a hero lies in. hero lies in you.
Awesome. Thank you so much for sharing this very special occasion with us. A special thanks to our producer, Brandilyn Thomas Pinkston, to all the members of FAAAC and to the Columbia Museum of Art, but most especially, thank you to our community for its support, and thank you, honorees, for all that you have done for all of us. It's not too late for you to join FAAAC, folks. If you are not a card-carrying member, this would be a good opportunity for you to take it. Now go check out that exhibit one last time. Fellowship, enjoy, and continue to support the arts.